Good afternoon. Welcome to another Post-Cult Worldview Ride-Along. In this episode, I want to talk about God. So far in this series, I've talked about atheism, theism, and deism, or deism, depending on how you pronounce it. Theism is the belief in an anthropomorphic God who has will, agency, and a plan. That God usually has a chosen people on earth and wrote a certain book. This God I do not believe in. I lack belief in a theistic God. Now, a deist is similar, at least a classical deist, in that they believe in a God with some agency and will, and maybe even plan, but just that plan doesn't involve us. So this is an absent God. It is anthropomorphic in that it is like us and has thoughts, but that it is no longer interested in what's happening with its creation, at least not human creation. Otherwise, we would see evidence of his involvement. Now, there are other ideas about God, and some of these even could be considered forms of deism, but I'm going to list them with different labels. The first one I want to mention is pantheism. And there are different forms of pantheism. One would be scientific pantheism. I have a book on this kind of pantheism, and I'll put a link in the description below to Amazon if you want to order the book for yourself. It's a short book, and it's basically atheism plus a feeling of reverence and awe for the universe. On the back of the book, it quotes Richard Dawkins as saying that pantheism is just sexed up atheism. These kind of pantheists might have so much reverence and awe for the universe that it actually affects their morality and their philosophy. It might change their diet or the way they treat the planet. Now, there are other forms of pantheism that do have more paranormal or supernatural overtones. There might be a sense that the earth itself has some kind of consciousness, or that the universe has some type of consciousness, and that we can experience some kind of oneness with that consciousness. And you'll see this kind of thing come up in New Age thinking, and it often relates to Native American or other indigenous peoples. And this kind of relates a little bit to animism, the idea that everything around us has a spirit of its own. But just to review, a pantheist is someone who equates the universe with God, that the cosmos or the universe is God. Now, there's something a little different called panentheism, which is the belief that God is the universe and more. So that the universe is part of God, but that God is not only the universe. So this is different from theism, which states that God is separate from the universe, God is out there, and then there's the universe. Panentheism kind of combines these two. God is the universe and is more than the universe. When I was a Jehovah's Witness, I had a form of theism that in retrospect was a little bit like panentheism. And I hope I'm pronouncing that right. But my idea was that Jehovah created the universe from himself. That if Jehovah always existed, and that he was the only thing that was existing, he had to make the universe from himself. Therefore, I am part of God. If I was made with God's Holy Spirit, his active force, then that force is in me, and I am part of God. You know, there's a section in the Insight on the Scriptures volumes on spirit. And I would love to read that section on spirit in the Insight volumes, because I was just fascinated by this idea that the spirit that animates me is the same spirit that God used to create the universe. And that there really is no substance difference between Holy Spirit and the Spirit, or the breath of life, that animates me. So in a sense, I am part of God, and all the universe is part of God. Now, I don't know how heretical that is from the perspective of a true believing Jehovah's Witness, but it was a thought I used to entertain, and I think it's similar to panentheism, as understood by many people. Now, there's one other one I want to mention, and that is pandeism. And that is the idea that there was a deity that existed, and that when that deity created the universe, he, she, it created the universe out of itself, and in so doing, ceased to exist as a deity. Now, there's an appeal to this. In my video about deism, I talked about the problem of evil. And I made the point that if there is a deity that created us and then ceased to interact with us, this is not a satisfying response to the problem of evil. It may be a response, and it's totally possible that it's true, but it certainly isn't comforting. So with the problem of evil, you have a theistic God who creates humans and is interested in us, but then allows suffering and doesn't intervene. And this is incongruous with the idea of an all-powerful, all-loving deity. So philosophically speaking, this refutes theism. Well, deism is a possible response to that. It says that, yes, there's a deity up there that is possibly all-knowing or is a intelligent designer. But because he's not interested in us, we can't blame him for the evil and the suffering that we see. He's just has nothing to do with it. Well, this is not comforting to me, because we're talking about a God who is a deadbeat dad. Just bails on his children. Well, pandeism is a possible solution to that problem, in that we have a God who is super intelligent and decides to sacrifice himself in the creation of the universe, and therefore ceased to exist as a thinking entity. There's no evidence for this at all. It's just an idea that exists in people's minds. And I personally find it implausible. It's not what I believe. But I understand the appeal of it. Because the universe is so profoundly beautiful and complex, there is a desire to invoke something out there that had to make it. Now, I'm going to return to pantheism, sort of. And in so doing, talk about and metaphor that I have for God. But before I do that, I need to talk about panpsychism. Now, I should probably do a dedicated video on the subject of consciousness and the hard problem of consciousness, but I'm going to try to say it as simply as possible. We can look at brain scans and see a correlation between certain emotions or responses with areas of our brain lighting up. So we can see a correlation between thoughts and certain physical responses in brain tissue. Though that would be talking about easy problems of consciousness. That's stuff that neuroscience is currently doing a really good job at analyzing. Although it is still in the early stages. Neuroscience is in early stages at this point. But those are easy problems of consciousness. The hard problem of consciousness is, why is it like something to have that type of response in our brain tissue? Why is it like something to see the color red? I mean, we can see how the brain reacts when we see the color red, but we don't know why we're having an inner experience of red. You know, there's something called the philosophical zombie, which is the idea that we can imagine a person who reacts to us and can have a conversation and can claim to be conscious, but is having no internal experience at all. Something like a computer. Like, we don't assume that a computer is having a conscious experience just because it can make calculations and figure out what the best chess move is to make. You know, for a human, it's like something to play chess, but it isn't, we assume, like anything for a computer to play chess. An illustration I like is to consider a bat. If you are a human and we were to take your consciousness and put it into a bat, if that would equal annihilation, that would mean that the bat is not conscious. But if you would continue to have an experience, that would mean the bats are conscious. And presumably the conscious experience of a bat is dramatically different than the conscious experience of a human. And you know, you would know what it's like to have sonar. So this is consciousness. It's not something that any amount of reading about neuroscience and breaking down and reducing our understanding of cells and neurons can ever explain. What is consciousness? So there is a theory out there, or a hypothesis would probably be a better word for it, called panpsychism. And David Chalmers is a philosopher who has spoken about this at great length, and I'll put a link in the description below for his TED talk on the subject. I'm fascinated by it. And it's the idea that consciousness is a fundamental, irreducible property of the universe, which is to say there is consciousness in everything. Now that is, it shouldn't be understood to mean that simple things like H2O, for example, are having thoughts or plans or memories or anything like that. Although there are people that think water has memory, and that's a whole other subject. But I don't think that a glass of water is having thoughts. But perhaps even simple molecules or even simple atoms and even electrons and protons and dark matter, all these things, there is a fundamental likeness to those. In other words, it's like something to be an electron. That's hard to get your head around, but it's a possible solution to this problem, the hard problem of consciousness. Why it is like something to be a human. And now our brains have been able to harness this consciousness and do amazing things that involve memory and planning and deep computation and thought and contemplation. But that consciousness that is at the root of all of that is intrinsic to the universe itself. Again, I'm not talking about the universe thinking exactly. I'm just saying it's like something to be the universe. So take that all the way back to the beginning, before there was any discernible matter. There was just some kind of quantum fluctuation going on. And you can read about that quantum soup, so to speak, in Lawrence Krauss's book, A Universe from Nothing. Now, he's not a panpsychist, but his idea of what was going on before the singularity, I'm suggesting that that quantum soup fluctuation, bubbling of possibilities, that there was, it was like something to be that. And from that sprang the universe. Now, I can't say that there's any intent there, and I'm probably making some kind of leap and suggesting that the universe, that this consciousness, this likeness, would want to bring forth the universe. But these are not fully formed thoughts, and I will not be held responsible for them. I'm not making any assertions here. It's an idea that I like to entertain, and I think there might be something to it, that perhaps someday science will be able to speak to. So imagine this consciousness, this likeness to the universe all around us, that it's like something to be anything. This is profoundly exciting for me. Now, you've probably heard the phrase, we are the universe becoming aware of itself. I think this is literally true, that now that we are able to think and reason and use philosophy to come down to moral and ethical conclusions and build religions around this philosophy and mythology, we are reasoning in ways that the universe previously couldn't. Now here I'm going to insert a metaphor that I use for God. Don't laugh at me. If you are a hardcore materialist, this is going to sound preposterous, and if you're, you know, a theist, this is going to sound blasphemous. But just keep in mind that I'm not making any literal assertions here. This is a metaphor. My metaphor for God is an infant. First of all, I find this metaphor useful because it is a response to the problem of evil, in that I don't have any expectations from an infant. An infant owes me nothing. An infant can't disappoint me. But an infant can love me. Now, when I meditate and sit quietly in contemplation, I feel a glow in my heart that cannot be described as anything else but love. And when I think of God being love, I love God in the sense that I love love itself. And I can love an infant, and an infant can have a love or connection with their parent. You know, that oxytocin that a mother feels, that's something that the child is experiencing too. There's a real connection that's happening. So I feel love for God in this sense. I feel like there is some kind of connection happening between me and whatever is out there. So to take that metaphor and kind of run with it, I feel like if I live my life in a more moral way, in a more ethical way that causes less harm and increases human well-being and human flourishing, that in some real sense, the universe is learning. And think again about that universe being an infant. I think it makes sense because for 13 and a half billion years, there was presumably no intelligence in the universe, no real planning or reasoning going on. Now, I'm not suggesting that humans are the only intelligence in the universe. There might be other intelligence out there, but presumably all the really intelligent beings that exist in the universe are a relatively recent development. So in this sense, the universe, having the ability to reason and think, is a very recent development. So this infant, the universe, is only beginning to be able to think about consequences for its actions. And I'm getting mystical here, but maybe as we become more and more aware of human flourishing and the effect we have on each other, as we become better as a species, the universe as a whole can actually become a more moral and ethical place. So I feel like my actions are going out there, my thoughts are going out there and having a positive effect on the global or universal consciousness, which may exist according to the hypothesis of panpsychism. And so when you take all that into account, it starts to sound like a form of pantheism. So in a sense, I believe in God. Although I make no strong assertions about it. Can you kind of get an idea of why I hesitate to call myself an atheist? You know, I'm a non-theist in that I don't accept any theistic assertions about God, that there is somebody out there smarter than us that has a will and a plan and so forth. But there are definitions of God that I find to be possible, that I'm agnostic about, and still others that I find useful if they can cause us to be more moral and more loving. So to identify as atheist shuts me off to these things. And if you're an atheist, you might say, no, it doesn't shut you off to those things. You can believe all the stupid crap you want or entertain all the stupid, irrational ideas that you want. And, you know, that may be the case for you, but for me, I need a little more elbow room than that. So I'm not a theist. I'm not a deist. I'm not a panentheist. I'm not a pandeist. But I might be some sort of pantheist. Let me know what you think about any of these different categories. Do any of them resonate with you? Do any of them sound plausible? Do any of them seem to be literally true? Do you feel there's evidence for any of those? Do you have evidence that you would like to share? I'd love to hear it. In the meanwhile, I'm enjoying just asking these questions. So thank you for watching. Remember that there are more things in heaven and earth than are dreamt of.